Well, forgive me, church is coming from my office this week. I forgot to record this last week. It's dumb, but I'll give it to you this way so you won't miss it. I want you to consider what you really want. What do you want? What do you really want? You know, I know in some ways I just think, I want my own way. My past, when I got my way, it didn't pay off well. So, you know, what do we really want? And today we'll look specifically at what do we naturally want versus what do we actually want. It's a tricky question because we've all gotten what we thought we wanted, and then found out quickly thereafter it was, you know, whether that been your first foray into dating, or whether that be, you know, your first car, or first thing, whatever. You know, you think you want it, and you go after that, and after a little while, you realize, it wasn't exactly what I wanted. Well, we can all relate to Paul's statement, you know, when he said, I do not understand what I do, what I want to do, I do not do. And what I do not want to do, that's what I end up doing. So what, how do we get that? I mean, when I consider, well, what do I really want, you know, I'll kind of default to sometimes, well, I want to please God. Well, what is that exactly? What is pleasing to God? What does he really want? And how do I live? What does my life look like if I'm trying to please God? The disciples had a lot of interesting questions, and they were able to sit right there at Jesus' feet. And so they asked some of those, and one of those was, well, how do we pray, Jesus? Teach us how to pray. And he said, Heavenly Father, you know, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And this secret of Heavenly Father, praying how your Heavenly Father wants things, it helps. You know, when God in human flesh, you know, God, part of the Trinity that who spoke the earth into existence, this is Jesus, when he talks to his, he's a Heavenly Father. There's an element of those fathers that gives us clues on how to consider some things. And today I want you to consider this element that what you actually want for your life is not that far from what God wants for your life. And the struggle that we each have is you just have to recognize there's stuff that I naturally want and there's stuff that I actually want. And separating between those two helps you identify. But God actually, as our Heavenly Father, he wants for us. He wants good things for us. And when we think of it that way, what does the Father want? It's easy for me as a father to consider, okay, what's best for my children? And I want that. And I recognize I want that. I recognize the things that I want for them are things that are good for them. And, you know, where on the other hand, when I think of myself, I have a lot of these natural wants and desires, and many of those things that I want, I know are not that good for me, are not that good long-term for me, are not something, they're just filling an immediate need type thing. So thinking like a father, you know, that really helps. And God knows. He knows you, he knows your heart. He made you. He made you the way you are. It makes you unique and individual. It wasn't God's fault, the sin issue, right? And that was from an outside source. But God still made you. And so he knows your wants and your own. what God wants, because God made those true needs. So Paul gives us a list of actions and things that if God had his way in our life, you know, we would do them and come out of it. And he said, you know, look at life this way. You know, look at as these actions as, you know, character traits growing out of you that are God's will working in your life. In Galatians 5:23, he said, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Now I get it. When we first read those scriptures and that scripture and those words, those character traits, they look a long way from me, from what I see in the mirror, from what other people tell me. For my character trait. And it's true. You know, and honestly, looking at those character traits, you know, honestly, you know, I have to say, do I even want some of those characteristics? Gentleness, self-control. There's things that I've learned through life wrongly, but I mean it's what life has taught me that you know, you just get take advantage of if you're too gentle, if you have too much self-control, if you don't stand up for yourself, if you don't do this, that, and the other, you know, people won't respect you. And, you know, we get these wrong concepts of how to respond to things. But I think it's honest, and God knows, you know, that when you see that in your life, and you're just honest about it, like, God, I don't even know that I want to be nice to that person. You know, I know the lifestyle they live. They've hurt me. They've abused me in the past. They've taken advantage of me. Or they're, I recognize that personality trait, and they will. When we just are honest with God on that, then he gives us insight, and he helps us actually even see those people in our different life. So that you know, he can accomplish what he's trying to do through us rather than us using our wisdom. But I think it's consistent that those things that I truly value in life that are from within me, you know, if I consider, you know, those traits I want for my children, for my girls, that's what I want their husbands to be, you know, to and for them. You know, so I value those traits, even though when I look at myself, I may not want to do them or want it that. So I just, you know, it helps to look at it from that perspective. Trick yourself into, you know, pursuing the right things. What do I want? What do I really want? What does God want for us? Looks a lot like what I really want to truly think are admirable things that I need. Love, joy, peace. You know, if I got better at that, if I pursued that better, then relationships work a whole lot better in my life. And when relationships are good, life is good. You know, whether that be at home, at work, outside the neighborhood, whatever. It's relationships that fulfill it and bring meaning into life, whether that be your initial one with God or whether that be even deep relationships with individuals. You know, relationships are key, and love, joy, peace. Pursuing those things helps your relationships big time. To love people that you really don't like because you know, they're not like you, or they don't treat you well, they don't act well, maybe they remind you of somebody who's hurt you. accepted Jesus Christ as my personal Savior, I recognized for the first time that I knew what joy was. I didn't even have a concept of what joy was before. I knew about pleasure and feeling good and being happy and that, but joy is a different feeling. You know, joy, you know, I saw joy in people at the hospital that I worked with that came out of these quirky little smiles and you know, then on Monday reflecting on how great Sunday was, and they didn't say what they did on Sunday, they just said, didn't we? That was such a good time, man. Oh, I really enjoyed it, and all that really felt meaningful to me, and then they just have these little quirky smiles, you know, that are, and it's like, I knew their lives weren't perfect. I was around them, I worked with them, I'd been in their cars, they were a piece of junk that was broken down, and I'd been over their homes, and I'd seen their parents, and they were a mess, and they were hard to get along with, but they worked to get along with them. I mean, their lives weren't perfect. Why did they have those smiles? And it was joy. And this joy doesn't have anything to do with our physical circumstances. After I accepted Christ as my Lord and Savior, I recognized the truth on this, that true joy comes from having a relationship with God, realizing that God left heaven, came to earth, lived and died to pay the price of my sin so that I could have a relationship with God, so that I could be a child of God, so that I could live eternally, that He desired for me in the first place. That simple fact, those simple truths, brings joy. And not all those circumstances in life or situations in life, they don't. That's just a reality. And it's really hard, you know, to understand that until you've experienced that. But on the other hand, as Christians, we have this amazing power to be light in darkness, to be an example of Jesus, to basically attract people with the joy that we know by simply not beating them over the head with it, but just being joyful at times when they wouldn't be. That you don't feel like you'd be joyful. Something just not good happened, but you're still happy because in the grand picture of schemes and things, you're going to heaven, you know. You're a child of God. God loves you. And so my car broke down. So what? Oh, we'll get through it. So this happened. So that happened. Even in tragedy, we don't understand it, to still have hope and faith and confidence in God. And that's where you can smile and say, well, God's going to have to do something great through this, and I don't understand how. But trust that type of joy attracts people, as it did me, because they know that is not natural, right? And you got something that they want. Joy is really, you know, love, joy, peace. When you have those three things, you have contentment, and contentment that's not brought by bank accounts or lifestyle or where you live or what neighborhood you're in or what you're driving. Contentment brought about by a knowledge of Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. People don't, they see that, they recognize that, and they, and everybody wants contentment. Peace, is another one of those things that everybody wants and everybody knows is, you know, in every beauty pageant, the right answer is world peace. You know, what do you want? Well, I want world peace. Oh, yeah, she's the one to vote giver. You know, everybody wants it, but you can't buy it. You can't get it by hard work, by doing this technique, you know. This world true peace only comes through a relationship with Jesus Christ, with God. And that has power in and of itself. You know, doctors make a living trying to sell peace. You know, somebody comes in and they just, oh, I just don't feel right. I just don't feel good. I just, you know, have this anxiety. I just worry about this and worry about that. And now, you know, I ache and I have this. And, you know, well, here, try this. See if this will help. And then there's a whole armada of drugs that they have to choose from to try to help you feel better, which ultimately it's not. It's lack of peace, which is causing, you know, these other symptoms. And, you know, it's just what it is. Your Heavenly Father wants you to have love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, self-control. These things He wants you to have. And you want to have them. You admire those qualities just like I do. It's just when we list, what do I want? Those things often aren't the first things we write, but they should be. They're what we can really pursue and get God's help in getting. Many times I know personalities that are, you know, power doers to get things done. They think, if I characterize these traits at work in the business world, you know, with my friends, I'll lose business, I'll lose money, I'll lose respect. And I never encourage you if you have thought that. That's wrong. You won't. I mean, you may lose some respect from some people that long term probably didn't respect you anyway. But you'll be way better off. You know, consider Paul, who wrote these scriptures. You know, he was the most educated man in the room. You know, none of us have educations even close to the level of studies and stuff that he went through. He was one of the most accomplished, successful person that existed in 30 years. He traveled most of the known world. And, you know, most of that was either on a boat or on foot. You know, he did that without cell phones, without the computers, without internet. For probably weeks at a time without a shower. He accomplished a lot, and he had a lot of wisdom from that. You're not going to be less doing what he has written and God has inspired him to encourage you to do. What he lived out himself. You will not be less effective at it. You'll be more. The truth is, you, like Paul, some people will emulate. You'll lead them into this lifestyle as well. And how effective is a team of people who aren't self-focused, who aren't fighting and bickering all the time, who are, you know, looking out for number one rather than just being part of a team that's a great team of God. Powerful team of people. You'll be more effective because some people will follow you in those actions. And those people will team up with you and you'll be far greater than you ever could have been. That's what God shows us. He concludes that scripture in verse 25. He says, since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking, or envying each other. Let's keep in step with the Spirit. And what this walking with God that we talk about is emulated what Jesus with his disciples. You know, when he called them, he didn't come with a list of rules, and he said, hey, here's, if you guys, you know, want to be my disciples, here's what you do. Here's the do's and the don'ts.
learn. If we're going to, you know, I think if the disciples, one of the questions they may have asked that wasn't recorded, or, you know, could have been asked, was, Jesus, where are we going? If we're following you, where are we going to go? I think Jesus could have answered, we're going to love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, self-control. That's the lifestyle that's fulfilling. Since we live by this Spirit of God, we don't walk with Jesus as they did. We have a different relationship, much better in my mind. We have the Holy Spirit of God with us right here in our heart. He knows what we're thinking. He knows as we pray, you know, what our motives are and everything. And he helps us in so many ways with guiding us and leading us. And what we can say is when, you know, as they walked with Jesus, as we walk with God, we're being led by that Holy Spirit. And he's our counselor. He's our guide. So we can say the same way. Since we live by the Spirit of God, let us keep in step with the Spirit of God. Let us not become conceited, provoking, or envying each other. That brings us to a much better place. God wants those things for us, and he'll help us to pursue them. He said, we can get what we ask for if we ask for the right motive. Trying to pursue what we actually want versus what we naturally want. You know, pursuing actual needs that God has put within us, wants that God has put within us. God will help us achieve those things. And they'll look a lot like those nine fruits of the Spirit. Those traits will come out when we choose to make decisions based on what God thinks rather than what we think, or what God wants rather than what we want. It's not a dreary life. You may think in the natural that, oh man, that would be a dreadful power. It's not. It's just the opposite. It's an exciting, miraculous, filled, joyful life. And it's what you were made to live. What we really want, not what we naturally want, but what we really actually want, what God wants for us. We just have to pursue, find out what that is, and ask for that. His plan for you is custom. So you can't just watch another person and follow and do exactly what they do. Certain things, you can learn good habits, you know, there's ways to pursue God and all that. But your purpose in life is different than everyone else on the planet. So God will use you in unique and specific ways. So you have to pursue God in that direction, and then pursuing that direction. What do you want? What do you really, really want? Ask that question to God. Have him help you discern the difference between your natural wants and your actual wants. That will guide you right into his will. And he'll help you accomplish those goals. Jeremiah 29:13 says, you will seek me and you will find me when you seek me with all your heart. God's not hard to find to a sincere seeker. He's just not. You just have to be honest and sincere. He's right there. Jesus 7:7-8, where life verses for me because it changed my life. Before I accepted Christ, I heard this scripture and it fulfilled and then do